Welcome to Back to Church Sunday. Today you are joining millions of other people in tens of thousands of churches across America and around the world. Thank you for joining us. We're glad you're here. You may have some memories or thoughts of what church is really all about. Is it a place to get married? A place you go when someone dies? A big potluck? Sometimes with that mystery dish. Bible stories on a flannel board? A place to sing hymns? It can be some of those things. But it is really learning to love God and to love others, seeing our relationships with family and friends grow stronger, serving our community, and a place to find hope in a world facing trouble. Also that we can share the incredible good news of Jesus with others who need this good news just like we do. We believe Jesus died on the cross and rose again to save us all, bringing us new life, healing, and peace. If it's been a while since you've been to church, or it's your very first time, or you're here every Sunday. No matter where you come from, or where you've been, we welcome you to our church.
Well, good morning once again. And I'm going to tell you, I really tried to keep that jacket on, but it just ain't going to happen. I'm starting to get hot up here, so I'm just going to get comfortable, and I'd rather sit down and talk with you than at you anyway. But I do want to invite you once again at the Odyssey Church on, this is really a one of the great events in our church history. Not only is it National Baptist Church Sunday, it's also our one-year anniversary. And as that video just stated, and I repeat it again, it doesn't matter where you are. It doesn't matter what your current beliefs are. It doesn't matter where you've been. It doesn't even really matter what you're doing right now. We love you. You say, well, we don't even know you. How can you love us? And that's because you're a child of God. And the child of God, Scripture tells us that we're to love each one of you. So we love you, and we just want the very best for you, and you're always welcome here at the Odyssey Church. Today we're actually joining about 30,000, a little over 30,000 churches worldwide, most of them in the United States, over 28,000 of them in the United States, as we do what's called National Back to Church Sunday. It's the largest annual community-based outreach effort in the entire nation, and we're glad you decided to spend it with us today. It all started because there was some research that was being done, and in that research it showed that 80% of all people that were currently not going to church would go to church if a friend of theirs asked them to go. But that same research showed that only 2% of churchgoers ever asked anybody to go to church with them that weren't already going to church. Now, it sounds ridiculously low. You know, only 2 out of every 100 people that are going to church, that believe in God, that say they believe in the Great Commission, would actually ask somebody to come to church. And 98 of them wouldn't ask, but that's what the statistics show. So they came up with this idea to have this National Back to Church Sunday as sort of a way to celebrate and get people to come back to church again. And a lot of people don't realize this, but as you read the scriptures, what you find out is Sunday's actually supposed to be the best day of the week. And the reason we celebrate and we go to church and proclaim Sunday to be the Sabbath, the reason we do all this on Sunday is because we believe, and the scriptures confirm it, that Jesus actually rose from the grave on a Sunday. In the Jewish, in the Old Testament, they would celebrate the Sabbath from sundown on Friday night to sundown on Saturday. But since we believe that Jesus rose from the dead, that he made his first appearance on Sunday, we actually take Sunday as our Sabbath. So not only is it a day of rest, it's actually a day of celebration as well. If you're familiar with the Lenten season, a lot of people say, well, I gave that up for Lent. Well, Sunday's a cheat day. That means that you can eat and do whatever you want. Whatever you gave up on Lent, you can have on Sunday, because Sunday is a mini celebration of Easter. Now, probably the most well-known verse in the Bible sort of explains it. John verse 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, so that everyone believes in him will not perish but have everlasting life. Now, that's something to celebrate. That's what we actually celebrate every Sunday. So Sunday is not only designed to be a day of rest, it's designed to be a day of celebration. And that's what we're going to do today. We are going to celebrate. And the thing is, even though God wants us to celebrate Sunday, I think all of you already know this, but for many of us, Sunday's just become another day in the rat race, right? I mean, it's just another day of the week almost. We live in this 24-hour, 7-day-a-week, 365-day-a-year world. So we find it hard to come to church and celebrate Sundays and celebrate this God who loves us with this radical, this unwavering, this unconditional love. And yet, this whole day was designed for us to celebrate, rest, relax, rejuvenate, refocus. And I sort of understand that because my old church days were a little bit different than what they are today. So I just want you to know that I can't condemn you because I was there. My favorite church was the horizontal holiness church. Sunday mornings, I would go there, and then I'd get up and I'd go to Methodist Mattress, and then sometimes I would get up and I would go to the, I'd go to the First Church of the Frigidaire with the Frozen Chosen, and then I'd go to Lazy Boy Lutheran, and then I always ended up at Bedside Baptist with Pastor Pillow, Brother Blanket, and Sister Sheep. So I'm just telling you, I understand where you're at. But so often in this world, we are influenced by our life experiences and by our past. And for some people, we just grew up in homes where Sunday was just another day of the week. We never even thought about going to church. And for some of us, Sundays were really disappointing because, and I know I've done this to my family on so many occasions, and I regret it. But Sunday's supposed to be a family day. The problem is you just don't ever do anything with your family, right? You just end up staying home. And maybe if you do something with your family, it's the things that you didn't want to do. Like if it comes yard work with dad, household chores with mom. And for a lot of us, and this is a problem in the world, Sunday was the day, you come from divorced parents, and Sunday was the day that you had to switch houses again. So Sunday's not always been a good day. It's not always been the day that God designed it to be. And I have to admit, even when my children were little, as much as I'm ashamed to state this, in our house, church was sort of mandatory. We were going to go to church, but this is how we went to church. We woke up at the last minute, every one of us, and then we ran around the house like chickens with our heads cut out, just trying to scramble out the door at the last minute. And when that happens, what happens? You all start arguing, you all start bickering, you're fighting all the way to church, and then you get in the church parking lot and go, put your little smiley face on, you're all walking through, like nothing's wrong. I see you smiling, y'all know it's there. But I want you to know, God never intended Sundays to be that way. I've got good news for you this morning. God created Sundays, not for him, but for you. Jesus himself spoke these words. The Sabbath was made to meet the needs of the people, and not people to meet the requirements of the Sabbath. See, the Sabbath was made for us. The Sabbath was made to meet our needs. We need a day to rejoice and a day to rest and a day to enjoy God and his creation. We need a day of celebration. But today we live in this world, we live in this time, we live where the pace of life is just killing us. And so today on National Baptist Church Sunday, I'm going to suggest to you that Sunday is the solution to the problem. I don't know about you, but I always feel like I got too much to do. God has said Sunday's the solution to that. It seems like I'm always under pressure. I'm always feeling pressure from somebody to do something. And God said the solution to the problem is Sunday. We rarely take the times for the things that are truly, truly important, the really important things in life. And God thinks Sundays can take care of that. There's never enough time for family or our loved ones or the rest we need. But God says Sundays can take care of all that. And there's so much going on in our world today. Just have to watch the news, pick up the paper, listen to the radio. And it's so easy to lose sight of what's really important. It's easy to lose sight of what really matters. And God created Sunday as a cure for all of that. So Sunday's the day we celebrate the Sabbath. It's not just a chore day where we have to get up and go to church. We get to go to church. We get to celebrate Sunday. It was made to meet our needs. It's designed to be a day of rejoicing and a day of rest. In other words, it's designed to be a day of celebration. And God wants to celebrate what he's done in us and through us and for us. So I'm going to tell you, some of you may not like this, but I'm going to need your kids' help on this because kids are always better. Today is Convocation Participation Day. Okay? Now, kids, you guys show the adults how to do it. The adults are really shy at times. So this is not a mandatory thing, but I'm going to tell you this whole message is not going to work very well if you don't participate. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to say, God wants us to, and then I need you to yell out, celebrate. Anytime I say, God wants us to, you got to yell out, celebrate, okay? Are you ready? Let's practice one time. God wants us to
celebrate.
All right. Man, you guys are good. I didn't expect that on the first try. See, we have these ancient
historical words for that. The celebrate.
I'll back the point.
Yeah.
You know, you can't. They're forced. They're oddities. They're, and you know what's really odd about them? If you pat them on the back, their head swells up. So. I'm just kidding. So anyway, we have these ancient historical documents we call our Bibles. And in our Bible, what's called the Old Testament, this prophet Isaiah, he says in 58 chapter, he says, keep the Sabbath day holy. Don't pursue your own interest on that day, but enjoy the Sabbath and speak of it with delight as the Lord's holy day. So the first point I want to make this morning, and remember this is congregation participation, is God wants us to
celebrate.
God wants us to celebrate Sundays. We're to keep Sundays holy and enjoy them and celebrate them with delight. What God has done in us and through us and for us. Not because we have some kind of law, some kind of requirement we have to meet, but because we need it. Because it was made for day, for us. Sundays help us keep focused on what's important. They keep us focused on God and there to be a day of rest. And our overall lifestyle becomes healthier so that we can live life and live it to the fullest. In the Gospel of John, one of the writers who gave a record and recorded the history of Jesus as a walk on the world, what we call the Gospel of John, he writes that Jesus actually said himself in his 10th chapter, 10th verse, he said, Jesus says, I came, so that they could live life and live it more fully. So that you could live life. It's not just about dying and going to hell. That's important. Overall, that's probably the most important thing. But it's so you can live here on this earth and live here more fully. Sabbaths are made for us. So this morning, if you like to follow along in your Bibles, today's going to be a little bit more difficult than usual. And trust me, I make it difficult every week. But I'm going to be speaking at several different sections of the Bible. One of the things they tell you never to do when you're in seminary, but I'm going to do it anyway. If you like the New Living Translation, which we normally speak out of here, we're going to use a couple different translations this morning. There are some up here. They're free. Please take them with you. We don't believe the Bible is just a book. We believe that the Bible is the book, and we want it in as many hands of people. So if you don't have one, you know somebody who wants one, please take them. They're free. We want you to have them. It's actually a love letter from God. People forget that. They think it's a list of rules. It's a love letter from God. He wants you to know that He wants you to be redeemed. He wants you to be set free from the things that hold you captive. And my hope, and I believe your hope, can be found in the pages of it if you just read it. Someone once said that this is the number one selling book in the world and the least read book in the world. So, not only does God want us to celebrate Sunday, God wants us to
celebrate.
God wants us to
celebrate
church. Now, sometimes people look at it and say, God wants to have us celebrate church? I think I can prove it by the psalmist David. Now, David was the king of Jerusalem, most people believe, when he wrote this. And it's in Psalm 122. And on your bulletins on the back, the verses, that the main verses are on there. If you didn't grab a bulletin, grab one on the way out. They have some notes in there. The very last one, if you have your bulletins, I forgot to get marked. That's actually going to be the Gospel of Matthew chapter 15, verse 10. But we're going to start out in Psalm 122, where I think I can prove to you that God wants us to enjoy church. Remember, we believe in the Odyssey Church that this book is inspired by God Himself. He took the talents of man, he used their life experiences, but it was God who whispered in their ears as they wrote it. So we believe this book is inspired. Inspired means God breathed is actually the word we translate inspired, what it means. So David is writing about a time in Psalm 122 when somebody invited him to church. David's response is recorded here in Psalm 122 in verse 1. I rejoice with those who said to me, let us go to the house of the Lord. He said, I rejoiced when somebody asked me to go to church. Another word for rejoice is celebrate. I celebrated when they asked me to go to the house of the Lord. That doesn't sound like a guy that's turned off by church, does it? That sounds like a guy who's excited about going to church. David got excited when somebody invited him to church. And I began to look at that first statement, and I began to think, well, why would David get so excited about going to church that he felt that it was so necessary to write about it? And as you read that song, and I'm not going to take the time to do that, because I want you to know it's just me and between you and the chicken. So I know how you all get when you get hungry, so I'm going to try to cut it as short as I can today. But as you read this, what you see is David gives all these reasons. Now, I would encourage you when you get home to read Psalm 122. It's only 9 verses. It's real short. And then try to pick out some of the reasons that you see that David got excited about the Lord in church. But look how he ends his writing. He says, for the sake of the house of the Lord, our God, I will seek your prosperity. So as you read through this, as you read through this psalm, David says, listen, I love you. And folks, I'm going to tell you, when you love the place that you're going, and you love the people you're with, and you love the reason that you're going there, it don't get no better than that. So I'm just going to take a few minutes, and tell you why I think that church is important, why I think you should celebrate church. And if this church is not your thing, I understand that. That's okay. Just get in a church and go somewhere regularly, and I think I can tell you some of the reasons why I think it's important, why Sunday should become the best day of the week for you. Now, I don't know if you remember this. It was sort of dwelling down when I was born. I mean, back in the 60s, it was the rock and roll revolution and the sex revolution and all these things were going around. And as I was growing up, it was starting to dwindle down. But there was a time in our country when everything stopped on Sundays. Even as a child, we had what was called blue laws. You couldn't work on Sundays. And people went to church every single Sunday. That's what they did. They went even if they weren't sure about God. They went even if they didn't quite believe that Jesus was who he said he was. But as they went and they heard the word of God, a lot of them came to believe. The body of Christ at that point in time was stronger than it's ever been. After church, they would eat together, and they would hang out together, and they would play together and have fun together. So like what we're going to do after church today. They would even take time to rest together. I remember growing up at my grandfather's house. Sunday was a day that we went visiting. Did anybody ever go visiting? That's what we did on Sunday. We went to church, and then we would go around and visit our neighbors, and we would eat, and we would have fun. It was not a day of work. Sunday was never just intended to be an extra day. It was intended to be a special day. It wasn't an extra day to get things done. It wasn't a day where we put our kids in sports and extracurricular activities. It was a day of rejoicing and resting and rejuvenation and celebrating. And you may not agree with me, but I think the people of that time, and we're going to look at it, I think they had a greater sense of peace. I think they had a greater morals than what we have in our country today. I believe our country was more united at that time. I think we had more hope at that time. I think the pace of life all week wasn't as frantic as it is today, because they would take that one day and slow the pace down, that one day a week, and they would rest and be refueled and rejuvenated, and they would focus on what really mattered. Now when I said I'm going to try to prove that, I'm going to try to do that. Try to picture a graph in your mind. Now, on this graph, the line, the vertical line, the one going up and down, it represents happiness, represents prosperity. And then the horizontal line going across this way marks years on a calendar. Now, if you were to draw a line that represented church attendance year by year, what you would see over the last couple of decades is church attendance has been declining. But if you were to take a separate line, and you would see the happiness of the general people in the United States, you would see that that's also going down. The lines don't intersect, they're almost parallel. Now, I can't prove this, but I believe that there's a relationship between overall church attendance in our nation, and the higher the church attendance is, the higher the happiness quotient is. Now, even though that may sound strange because you really, you can't taste it, you can't feel it, you can't see it, the fact is, if you were to draw those lines, you would see that's exactly what's happened. So I believe this, and it's okay to disagree with me. Those that know, you know, a lot of people disagree with me. You have the right to be wrong, I'm okay with that. But I believe the reason, the higher the church attendance is in the nation, the happier the people, is because there's just something you can't see, you can't touch, you can't taste, you can't smell about church attendance. There's just something that makes us better and qualifies us for special blessings and special provisions from God. Once upon a time, Sunday was the best day of the week for almost everybody. Now, some of you, you may remember growing up, Sunday was always one of my favorite days of the week. And now it's sort of, in our world, it's sort of just become another day. At one point in time in our country, life was better for almost everybody, even in some of the worst times, because they were rested, they were refocused, they were rejuvenated. And you know what? I want that again for our country. But more importantly, and maybe I should say, I want that for you. I want that for me. I want that for those of us that are in this room. Let me give you a couple reasons why I believe you should invest in a weekly Sabbath and in weekly church attendance. Number one is you need it, and I need it. And I really can't speak for you, but I know that I need it. Scripture says God rested on the seventh day. Did he have to rest? Did he quit making this earth spin around? No. He was telling us, I'm going to lead by example. I'm going to show you. Jesus didn't even get baptized. He was sinless. He did it so he would show us what to do. Amen. God gave us an example of what to do. That's why he put it in his top 10 rules. He put it in the 10 commandments, number 4 on the list. God's not trying to flatten your fun or lessen your life by taking a day away. He just wants you to increase. He just wants you to have more joy. He just wants you to improve your life by giving you a day to celebrate, a day to refresh, a day to rejuvenate, a day to refocus on Him because He knows we need it. And number 2, God blessed the Sabbath for reasons known only to God. He blesses the Sabbath. It's not an extra day. It's a special day. And here's what I found out in my life. This is what I've seen in the life of others. I got a testimony of it this morning. It was amazing. God just reaffirming is that when we cooperate with what God blesses, I found in my life and the life of others, we get blessed back. Did you know statistically, according to almost every study, statistically, those that attend church versus those that don't attend church, the church attenders live longer. One study said the average regular church attender lives 7.5 years more than the person who doesn't go to church. Overall, the people who attend church are healthier, statistically, study after study after study. So some people say they don't have time to go to church. Maybe the fact is they don't have time not to go to church. Number 3, life goes better. My life gets better. I think your life will go better when we take a Sabbath and we attend church. And I know I gotta be here. It's part of the job description. But I wasn't always a pastor. But when I started attending church, and those of you who know me, I've gone through some difficult times. I was able to handle them and get through them better because I was rested. I wasn't worn out from everything I did on Sundays. My Mondays got better, but not only did my Mondays get better, I wasn't exhausted, so my whole week got better and I got more things to talk about. My life is simply better when I celebrate a Sabbath and when I attend church. And this last one, it is really important to me. My family is better. You know, whether my family attends church, some people use the excuse, my kids can't come, my wife can't come. But I'm going to tell you, when I attend church, whether my family attends or not, I'm rested. I get refocused on God. I become a better person. I'm able to be a better husband. I'm able to be a better father. I'm better at leading my household. So my whole family is better when I take a Sabbath and when I attend church. I just do life better. When I celebrate the Sabbath. And I had regular church attendance, and this was long, long before I ever became a pastor. And I didn't go to church out of some kind of legal requirement because I felt it was something that I had to do, because when you feel like you have to do it, it just takes away the joy. But when I knew I got to go to church, that I looked forward to the singing, I looked forward to learning about God's Word, I looked forward to seeing what I could do it and apply it to my life, I just was better. My life got better. And I believe that if you would take time, if you're not a regular church attender, if you would take time and come to church, and again, whether it's this church or another church, just between now and the end of the year, just give yourself 4 months. Go to church somewhere on a regular basis. Because I can tell you, if you go and your life doesn't change, it may be that you're not taking what you're learning there and applying it to your life. But if you decide it, that will take you back. He's okay with that. I mean, just do what you're doing now. After 4 months, your life ain't changed. Just quit going to church. I'm telling you, from personal experience, from the people I talk to, from what I see in this church, the miracles God's done, when you rest, when you take a Sabbath, when you attend church, your life is simply better. So what is it God wants us to do? He wants us to
celebrate.
Celebrate. He wants us to celebrate Sundays. He wants us to celebrate the Sabbath day. In the Old Testament, Exodus chapter 31, Moses writes, keep the Sabbath. Celebrate it for all time to come. It is a covenant that lasts forever. God not only wants us to celebrate the Sabbath, He wants us to celebrate our Sabbath, our Sundays. He wants us to celebrate church attendance. He wants us to celebrate church like King David did, a man who God said was after His own heart. Psalm 100 verse 4 says, enter His gates with thanksgiving. Go into His courts. In other words, go into His church with praise. Give thanks to Him and praise His name. And now, I want you to see, God wants us to
celebrate.
He wants us to celebrate His mighty acts. God wants us to celebrate what He's done in us. He wants to celebrate what He's done for us and what He's done through us. I don't know if any of you know or have heard of a man by the name of Charles Spurgeon. He was a great 19th century preacher. He was known as the Prince of Preachers still today. He said, and he wrote these words, all the attributes of God are fitting subjects to be celebrated by the music of our hearts and the voices. And when we observe the display of His power, we must extol it. We must glorify it. He wrought. He formed our deliverance alone, and He alone is to be praised. Charles Spurgeon wrote those words. He was referring to a verse in Psalm 21, which is another Psalm of David. Psalm 21 says, how the king rejoices in your strength. Oh Lord, he shouts with joy because you give him the victory. See, as I talk to people outside the church, they always think it's them that gets the victory. You know, I worked hard. I got it. It was what I did. I did. David, who was close to God, a man after his own heart, says, I know there's nothing in me, God. If I get a victory, it's because of you, and I'm going to rejoice because of your power, not my power. God does give us all different talents. God gives us different things that we can do and different things that we can't do. But as you draw closer and closer to God, you'll see no matter how much talent that you have, if you get a victory, it is always from Him. I've seen many talented people fail. But victory comes from God alone. And when we have that victory, we need to know it from God, and we have to rejoice in His power and in His strength and shout for joy because He has given us the victory. And David goes through this psalm, and again, it's one I encourage. It's only 13 verses. I encourage you, right? David goes through it. He tells of the mighty acts that God's done for him, how God had fulfilled the desires of his heart, about the victories, about the accomplishments, how God had even given David throughout the years protection and the blessings and the joys he experienced in being in God's presence. How God had saved him from an enemy. And then David ends his psalm like this. He says, rise up, O Lord, in all your power. With music and singing, we celebrate your mighty acts. they would celebrate all the things that God had done, rejoicing in his mighty acts. That's what we're doing today. That's what today is all about. Today is a day of celebration as we remember the victories that God has given us over the past 12 months. I want you to see how far we come. Here's a picture from one of our first services. That's this room, okay?
That's it, yeah.
We had steel chairs. Some of you remember, they were cold.
And they were borrowed.
And they were borrowed. The concrete floor was stained and messy, and you can't tell it. These walls were horrible. And we didn't have curtains. All you saw was the garage door. There was no stage. There was nothing.
No backdrop.
Now, it's only been 12 months. We're rejoicing in what God has done for us. I'm telling you, this is nothing less than a miracle. God has provided. God has led other churches like Mariners Bethel down the road, like Kent United Methodist, like Mount Hermon United Methodist. They've all come in partners with us. They've led us and they've given us stuff just so that we can have what we need, our soundboard.
And the carpet.
And the carpet was donated by Home Depot. I mean, we've just been blessed as people have partnered with us as God has given us and shown us his mighty acts, and we're celebrating. Many of the people in this room, you've been instrumental through your obedience, through God's power, through your giving, through your volunteering, and your sharing of the talents that God has given you to help us get where we are. So we're singing and celebrating the mighty acts of God and rejoicing because God has given us the victory. And it's important, as important as that is, as important as these material things are. They help us in helping people find Jesus and helping people follow Jesus and lead them in a different relationship, deeper relationship with him. But the thing that we celebrate most is this. Folks, I'll tell you, God can't get praise for this. Lives are being changed. Lives are being changed. Not just for today, but for all eternity. That may not seem a lot to people that are going to bigger church, but we have had 10 first-time confessions of Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. We've had 8 first-time baptisms. We've had 3 people rededicate and get baptized to their life, publicly rededicate their lives to Jesus Christ. We've had at least 3 children dedications, all in the last 12 months. We've got conversation groups on Wednesday night. We got home churches on Sunday, on Thursday night. We got youth groups on Friday night. We've got a music team, all in 12 months. It's not possible with man, but with God, all things are possible. God wants us to do what?
Celebrate.
God wants us to celebrate Sundays. God wants us to celebrate church. God. He wants us to celebrate church by actually going to church, okay? God wants us to celebrate his mighty acts. His mighty acts for giving us our heart's desires at times. I see some of you with children, harm your children. What a heart's desire that is. He gives us his mighty acts of protection. And truthfully, I think if we could see the things that God protects us from that we don't even know about, we'd never question his love. We'd never question his plans for our life, even in the worst of times. But there's one mighty act. There's one mighty act that not only do we celebrate, but God celebrates with us. There's one thing that God celebrates with us, and that is God celebrates salvation. God wants us to celebrate not only our own salvation, but the salvation of others. Salvation. Some people don't even know what it means to be saved. I'm saved. What does that mean? Well, I believe in Jesus. We are a church of love, and we believe in God's grace and God's mercy. But I don't believe you can understand how great his love is unless you understand his wrath. The Bible tells us none of us deserve to go to heaven. Even our most righteous acts are like filthy rags to God. So when we say we're saved and we have salvation, what that means is we are saved from the wrath of God. And when that happens, God himself celebrates. We celebrate. I don't think there's nothing that pleases God more than somebody becoming a Christian through believing in their heart that Jesus is exactly who he says he is, confessing with their mouth, not only that he's Savior, because a lot of people do that. Scripture says, confess with your mouth that he is Lord. And I think think when somebody does that, that is the thing we should celebrate the most. The free gift of salvation not only lets you live a more peaceful life here on earth, but it lets you live for all eternity with your Creator, with the Lord Jesus Christ. The free gift of salvation lets you spend eternal life in heaven as well. Folks, let me ask you, what good is the gift that's left under the tree? What good is the gift that you never receive? What good is the gift that you never open the package to? It's free. He's offering to you. All you've got to do is take it. Accepting Jesus Christ, the Messiah, as your Lord and Savior is the best decision you'll ever make. And not only should we celebrate our salvation, we should celebrate the salvation of others. When I get tired, when I get weary, as I often do, when I get frustrated and feel like throwing in a towel, if you go back to my office, which might not want to do, but it's pretty bad.
Don't go back.
But on that wall are the 10 confessions of Jesus Christ we've had this year. And when things get tough, I just go back there and look and I say, this is why we do what we do. It's not in your power, Rob, it's in God's power. But you got to do your part before God. And they love celebrating salvation. But I want you to look at the words of Jesus in the Gospel of Luke, chapter 15, verse 10. And I want you to pay attention to what it says. I tell you, there is rejoicing in the presence of angels of God over one sinner who repents. Now see what I believe? Is the angels are rejoicing? But that is not what Jesus said. Jesus says, there is rejoicing in the presence of the angels of God. Who do you think standing in the presence? I believe it's Jesus Christ. I believe it's God Himself standing in the presence of the angels. And when one sinner repents, God Himself rejoices with the angels. And if God rejoices over them, how much more should we rejoice over the same thing? See, when somebody repents, and we get it so wrong, and the church has messed it up for so years, when we think repent means you just got to stop doing what you're doing, and you tell yourself to stop doing it, and all your brain is saying, if you tell me to stop, it's like telling a three-year-old to stop. The more you tell them to stop, the more they're going to do it. What it means is we repent. The root of the word repent means we change our way of thinking. Instead of thinking about ourselves, we start thinking about God. And when you start thinking about God and what God would want you to do, you're changing your way of thinking, you're repenting, and you begin to live for Him and not for yourself. And when you do that, I believe God rejoices in the presence of His angels. When somebody believes in their heart that Jesus died on that cross for them, when somebody confesses with their mouth that Jesus rose from the grave as proof that God was satisfied with the sacrifice that Jesus made and confesses with their mouth, Jesus Lord, I think God celebrates that more than anything else. Someone who was lost has now been found. Somebody who was outside the kingdom of heaven is now on the inside of the kingdom of heaven here on earth. Somebody who was living for themselves is now living for Him. So you know what we're really celebrating today? We boil all this down. What we're celebrating today really is life. Life here on earth and life in eternity. We're celebrating lives that have been impacted by Jesus Christ. The Apostle Paul reminds us in the letter he wrote to the Christians in Rome, how can they call on Him to save them unless they believe in Him? And how can they believe in Him if they've never heard about Him? How can they hear about Him unless somebody tells them about Him? So I want to challenge you this morning to celebrate something. Celebrate going to church. And if you don't have a church, we would love you to come back here. But if this church isn't your thing, just pick out a church somewhere and try it for 4 months. Just start going somewhere on a regular basis. Make Sundays the best day of the week again. Get rested. Get rejuvenated. Get refueled. Get refocused. Celebrate Sundays by going to church and then celebrate church itself. And you'll find, just like I did, that you need it. You'll find just like I've seen in so many lives that God has blessed it. Life will go better, and even your family life will get better when you celebrate Sundays and celebrate God's house, the local church, the body of Christ. And then celebrate his mighty acts. And if you're thinking to yourself, well, I'm going through so much trouble right now, I don't even know if God's ever done a mighty act in my life. I'm going to read them to you because I don't want to sing, but then you all be rushing out the door. I'm going to read you the words of an old hymn, and it'll tell you how to get started. It says, count your blessings, name them one by one. Count your blessings and see what God has done. Count your blessings, name them one by one. Count your blessings and it will surprise you what the Lord has done. You just sit there and you meditate. You start thinking about what God has done in your life. And the more you think about that, the more you'll be able to celebrate His mighty acts. And then finally, celebrate what God celebrates most. Celebrate salvation. Celebrate your salvation. Celebrate the salvation of others. If there's somebody in here today that doesn't know this Jesus that we've been talking about, I would ask you to please see me after the service and I'll introduce him to you. If you have questions about our church, find one of those people that you see on stage or in the back and talk to them or see me. If you want to know how to receive Christ in your heart, I'll be glad to introduce you. But I'm going to ask you right now, if you'll stand with me and let's do this thing just one more time. God wants us to
celebrate.
So let's celebrate.